You know, Brother Greg said earlier, you know, yesterday was Mother's Day. And Mother's Day is, the celebration between the mother and the children. Hence the name Mother's Day. You know, but the husband on Mother's Day, he was relegated to the purpose of, fulfilling our bonds of guilt. He is David.
That's right.
Tonight, May the 10th, this is Wives Day. We're going to do a song for the wives out there. And we're going to do this song. And the third chorus, you guys, I want y'all to take your wives, look her in the eye, and y'all going to sing this song with us. This is your opportunity to let her know what you This is not exactly a gospel song, so I hope we don't get church.
On my finger.
gonna call that.
I see Latter-day Saints speaking out over there. Totally understand. I am so excited to be here tonight. Yeah. normal reasons, just because I like to go to Cowboy Church and get to get to. So good to see my old partner Blaine here tonight. I give Blaine a hand. I'm so glad you're here. And it is so good to see each and every one of you. It was so awesome to watch y'all sing to your wives. That was inspiring. You know, it just warmed the cockles of my heart.
It just
really got to Marshall. Marshall, I appreciate your rendition over there. It was really special. All of y'all, that was good, brother. I just made up with you. I'm so proud of you guys. So proud of you guys. All right, I've made enough fun of y'all. All right. I will tell you what, man. I've been trying to get something on Cowboys here for, I don't know, 6-8 months now. But that right there, I done figured it out. Bring up a little romance and watch them Cowboys, man. Say something sweet to your wife. Compliment your bride. Tell her she's pretty. Oh, well, speaking of wives, husbands and wives, here's my joke for tonight. It's called the silent treatment. A man and his wife were having some problems at home. Not that any of us know nothing about that. And they were giving each other the silent treatment. About like y'all was singing a while ago. Suddenly, the man realized that the next day, he would need his wife to wake him up at 5 o'clock for an early morning business flight. Not wanting to be the first to break the silence and lose, he wrote on a piece of paper, "Please wake me up at 5 o'clock. He left it where he knew she would find it. The next morning, the man woke up. It was 7. He was 2 hours late and had done missed his flight. Furious, he was about to go see what in the world, why his wife hadn't woke him up. Then he noticed a piece of paper by the bed. The paper said, "It's 5 o'clock, honey. Wake up." There's an editorial comment that says, "Men are not equipped for these kinds of contests." Oh, man. And then to just top it off, man, we have got the best text tonight. It is John chapter 10. John chapter 10. And we're going to start at verse 7. While y'all are finding that, I'm going to remind you what the 23rd Psalm says, because it goes along with this. Aren't these words beautiful, the way they blessed our lives? "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." My favorite part is right here. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. But thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Let's stand together as we read John 10, beginning with verse 7. John chapter 10, beginning with verse 7. "Then Jesus said to them again, Most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep." We talked about that earlier. "All who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. And if anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he's a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring. and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. That's talking about us. Therefore, my Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your many blessings.
Yes.
God, we thank you for the wonderful, sweet, sweet spirit of fellowship at Capitol Church. We thank you, God, that you just choose to be with us, and we sense and feel your presence every Monday. Lord, I thank you for that. I thank you, God, for the opportunity to be here. Thank you, God, for our time of worship, our time of fellowship, for our prayers and prayer requests. I pray, God, that you just open up your text to us. God, show us the wonderful revelation that Jesus is our good shepherd. Bless our time together, for we ask these things in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Guys, can be seated. All right. The good shepherd. I don't want to spend a lot of time introducing this because I want to get right on into this. There are seven I am sayings in the Gospel of John, two of them right here. I am the door, and I am the good shepherd. And he's using the door illustration as a part of his discussion about the shepherd. So Jesus describes what a good shepherd is. He describes the qualities of a good shepherd. I love the phrase. It's a modern day phrase. I say modern is 10 years old probably. But I love the phrase that God is good all the time. Y'all like it?
Amen.
I find it descriptive. I find it biblical. I find it theologically sound. I find it absolutely true. God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. I don't think any passage of Scripture teaches us about the goodness of God any more than the Good Shepherd. I am the Good Shepherd. And he's a good, good Father. Nothing is more obvious for some of us. You know, some of us were like, well, duh, yeah, God is good. Can't be nothing else, right? And yet, it's one of the most debated topics that you can imagine. It's one of the most debated things that this lost and dying world wants to talk about. It's an amazing thing to talk about. And even some Christian circles, their views of God focus so much on the greatness and authority and sovereignty of God that they miss out on teaching and believing and trusting in how good and loving that God really is. It is an amazing thing. I had something absolutely amazing happen yesterday. I was preaching on the home and marriage. I was preaching on divorce. And I was talking to them before I even got started. I told them, I said, I'm not here to beat anybody up. It's not the scripture. It's not any use in it. I'm not here to beat anybody up about past failure of any kind. We're here to talk about from this day forward. We're talking about something we do something about.
Amen.
Like Paul said, this one thing I do, put my past behind me. I had a lady that was so, so broken up over that day and that message. And she came to me after church and said, I did not know that God had forgiven me for my divorce. Until I heard you preach tonight. And you know, I had another moment. I had another moment. Well, we had baby dedication. And this guy told me, I said, what's this baby's name? He said, the baby's name is Grace. I said, oh man, that's my favorite name. He said, I know it is. He said, it's my favorite name too. And the day I got saved, you preached on Grace. And she's a walking reminder that Grace is where we get it to. I mean, they almost, that was so good in his church yesterday. I had so much fun, so much good. I almost thought I was at Cowboy Church every Saturday. I done thought I'd rolled up to Cowboy Church, man. Anyway, I want to tell you about the Good Shepherd tonight. I want to tell you five really quick things. Don't get nervous. It is a five-point sermon, but these are five really quick things. Now, matter of fact, you don't watch out, you'll miss them, man. I'm telling you, I ain't going to spend much time on any of them. Number one, the Good Shepherd provides.
Amen.
The Good Shepherd provides for the sheep. Here's what he said, the enemy, he comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Now, in case you didn't know who that is, that's the devil.
Amen.
Amen. And that lowlife, good for nothing, sorry, red-eyed, lowlife, good for nothing, lying, I already said good for nothing, good for nothing, lying, cheating, stealing, killing devil, I just want you to know tonight, he is a slob, a slouch, a lowlife, he's defeated. He's headed for the lake of fire where he will be tormented day and night forever.
Amen.
That's his future. That's where he belongs. And that's what he's about. He wants to hurt people. And his only agenda is that. That for no reason. For no reason whatsoever. No agenda whatsoever. Just to hurt people. And so that's what he's about. To kill, steal, and destroy. But the Good Shepherd says, that's not why I came. I came that they might have life. And that they might have it more abundantly. Isn't that a beautiful phrase?
Amen.
They might have it more abundantly. Man, is that true or what? When we come to know Jesus, we have eternal life. How long does eternal life last? Forever. If it ain't forever, it ain't eternal. We come to Him, we have eternal life, and we have a life that's worth living in Him right then and right there. What an amazing thing. With Christ, there is nothing but life. And without Jesus, there is nothing but death. With Him, without Him. It's a clear choice. A clear, clear, clear choice. The Good Shepherd provides for His sheep. He provides in the Psalm 23, green pastures and still waters. Those sheep are so woolly, they get up in that water, they'll drown, you know. And they're really dumb, too, they tell me. That's why cowboys like cows, I guess. I don't know. Let me start on nothing I don't know about. Here's something I do know about. One of the names for God is Jehovah Jireh, and it means He who provides.
Amen.
He is the Lord who provides. He takes care of His sheep. Number two. Don't we're going to go that fast. Number two, the Good Shepherd knows the sheep. Now, at first, that might not seem like such a big deal, but it is a big deal. It is a big deal, and it's something I know for a fact cowboys are going to know about. Because y'all know y'all's cows. You know, people like us, we get out there, they're just cows. That's a cow, there, you're a cow, there, a cow, over there, a cow. I mean, you know. But y'all, I got the cows named, and you know, this cow, and all that. Y'all got some probably bad names, or no, sweet names, Daisy, Honey Daisy, and all that. Daisy Dad, I used to have a good friend. I don't know if any of y'all knew Willard Cooper. Did any of y'all know Willard Cooper? Willard was a good friend of mine. He married Miss Doris Cruz. Miss Doris and Otis and Ab, they used to cowboy down in the swamp. So anyway, that's probably before y'all's time. Anyway, so Miss Doris and Willard gets married late in life. Otis had been gone many, many, many years. And so she and Willard got married. I married them. It was one of the best things for them, for our community, our church. They were just a power couple in our church. We loved them to death. Hey, boy, Willard, I got to tell you this. Back then, it was a long time ago, back in the 90s, there was a popular pair of tennis shoes that came out called Reebok Pump Ups. And the kids, they reached down and they would pump the basketball on the tongue of the shoe. And they would imagine that those shoes were getting full of air and that they could jump high with them. Well, Willard don't know nothing about no tennis shoes. All he knew was my oldest son wanted a pair and I told him I didn't have the money for it. Next thing you know, I had the money for him. Amen. Wasn't that fine? He just handed me $100 bill. He said, "Will that buy them shoes?" I said, "Yeah, sure will." And he said, "Well, go buy that." And he didn't know what to call me. He said, "Go buy that boy some puff up shoes." We went riding through his pasture on a mule, and my little son, he wasn't about 5 or 6 years old at that time, and about he got some, you know what, on his cheek over here. And he said to Willard, he said, "Mr. Wood, I got some mud on me." And Mr. Wood, "Son, that ain't mud." I'll tell you, man, we had the best time. If you ever drive by Longview Church, we had the first money for that building that ever got gave. That was some good grammar up in there. Ever got gave. Ooh. I guess that's all right. Anyway, it's just an amazing thing to think about how the shepherd knows the sheep. And the reason I tell Willard stories It's because we was out there, and he said, you know, he had a bunch of cows out there, and Miss Doris had a bunch of cows out there. So, you know, student Steve, I just asked him another question. Well, how do you know whose cows is what? She said, he said, well, hers are the ugly ones. You know, and then he told me, now we mark them, you know, we put a mark on them, you know, and so we, you know. But anyway, it was just the funniest thing. But them cows, you know, people know them. Them shepherds, they know their sheep. You can see pictures of places where they have lots of shepherds and sheep. And they get out there, and them shepherds get on different hills and go to holler, and them sheep just separate. And they go their own shepherd. They run over there, and they just line up in the right place. They just know their shepherd, know their shepherd's voice, and the shepherd knows them. Isn't that an amazing thing? It's an amazing thing. It is an amazing thing that he knows us. You know, he know, the Bible teaches that he knows how many hairs are on top of your head. Now, he didn't have to count long on some of y'all.
Move on.
Jesus, move on. You know, we said a while ago, we y'all started the service off right here. You stole my notes, man. Our name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. We don't have a number, we have a name. Amen.
Amen.
Isn't that awesome? I'll be right there in the Lamb's Book of Life. Steve Goober Spear, right there. Dr. Steve Goober Spear, right there, brother. I'll tell you, it's an amazing thing that Jesus knows us. He knows each and every one of us. The lyrics in the song, When He Was on the Cross, it's one of my favorite songs, and one of my favorite lyrics. And the part that just busts me up, man, the part that just gets to me is this right here. He knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine. I'm so unworthy of such mercy. But when he was on the cross, you know, people train their ears to hear things.
Yeah.
The two boys that I play with at my church on Sunday morning, those boys have an ear for music. Oh my goodness, it's crazy. Now, you can be playing along, you'll get to the end of a chorus or a verse or something. Old Lawrence Lambert, old Chief Lambert, he'll say, G strings a little, you need to tune it up a little bit. Of course, I get nervous when he talks about G strings. Your A string's a little flat, brother. Just don't say your G string's a little flat. Your A string's a little flat, brother. You need to do something with it. He is trained. He can hear that. I never will forget, y'all. My grandpa was one of those ace mechanics. You know, back years ago, when they had points and condensers and all that stuff, you had to work carburetors. He had to work on them and finagle with them to keep them going all the time. He was an ace at that. And I have watched with my own eyes. If I didn't see it, I wouldn't believe it. I have seen my dad call my grandpa and take the phone to the door and get my mama to rev the car up so grandpa could hear it run. You know? I'm like, oh my goodness, that man had trained his ears to hear what was going on. I'll tell you something that is a curiosity to me. It's just a beautiful difference. Men and women are different. And mamas and daddies are different. But you can be in a crowded room of people and lots of noise going on, and you'll see some little girl, some little lady, 23, 25 years old, and all of a sudden, she'll bolt, man. I mean, like her hair is on fire or something. And the next thing you know, she done wrapped up some squalling kid somewhere. She heard that. I didn't hear it. You didn't hear it. Her dad probably. The boy mama heard that. Mama's trained her ear to hear that, hadn't she?
Amen.
You know, people are training. I want to tell you something tonight, Capital Church. We need to tune our ears to hear Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
We need to hear our shepherd when he speaks to us. Wow. So the good shepherd He provides for the sheep. He knows the sheep. He guides the sheep. Yea, they will by no means follow a stranger, but will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of a stranger. In Psalm 23, it says, He leads me in the paths of righteousness. Isn't that cool? And then I told you when we was reading, my favorite part of the 23rd Psalm is the one little word through. Yea, though I walk through.
Amen.
He doesn't take me to the edge of the valley and say, all right, Stephen, I do the best you can. You know, all right, root hog or die, right? No, that's not what he says. If that, listen to what Drew Brees, I know y'all ain't into football, I get that. I'm sorry about all that. But anyway, old Drew Brees wrote a book, Coming Back Stronger, and you'll like the book if you ever read it. And here's what he said. If God brings you to it, God will bring you through it.
Amen.
That's pretty strong. Pretty strong, right? Amen. If God brings you to it, God will bring you through it. The 23rd Psalm absolutely promises that. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. I'm not afraid. Why? Because thou art with me.
Hallelujah.
I get to the valley, I ain't alone.
That's right.
Now look, I'm telling you, at 61, I turned 61 2 days ago. Wow. Let me tell you something. At age 61, I've been to a valley or two. Yeah. Several of them. Mm. Big ones. Dark ones.
Yeah.
Tough ones. But I've never been to the valley that he wasn't there waiting on me.
Amen.
And I've never gone through the valley alone.
Amen.
Good grief of Moses. I ain't even gone through the valley on my own strength.
That's right.
He's packed me through the valley over and over and over again. So much so, so well so, so strongly that later in life you look back on that deep, dark, terrible valley and thank God for it. Because the good shepherd brought you through it.
Yes.
You know that next deep dark valley that comes up, you ain't going to have no problem with it neither.
Amen.
Because the same Lord Jesus is going to be with you.
Thank you.
Man,
thank
the good you, shepherd, he guides us. Number four, I told you we were going fast, man. The good shepherd protects the sheep. It says one who is a hired hand runs from the wolf, but the good shepherd protects the sheep at all costs. Man, isn't that amazing how he protects the sheep? You know, the Bible says that King David, as a shepherd, killed a bear and a lion. He wasn't very real. He just wasn't really scared of Goliath when he ran up on him because he done whooped the bear and done whooped the lion. Can you imagine being Jesse, his daddy? I just can't imagine. Son, how was your day? Well, yeah, I killed a bear. Son, did you have a good day? Yeah, I killed a lion. Can you imagine? And I'm like, you know, he ain't killed no bear, no lion with no 30-06. He ain't shot no laser bomb at him. That's what I'd shoot. Yeah, one big bombs, you know. He has killed this bear, lion. I don't even know how. I'm telling you right now, it was hand-to-hand combat, hand-to-paw. You know, beat him. I don't know how he whooped him. I don't know how you whoop a lion or a bear. I'm scared of a dog. I ain't about to take on no lion. Amen? But no, man. Whew. No, man. I'm scared of all kinds of critters. Mm. And then think about a bear. You can't even whoop a bear. But a bear outruns you. You try to swim, you outswim you. Try to climb up a tree, you outclimb you. I mean, it's just a bad thing. Y'all heard about that Christian bear, though, didn't you? You heard about that Christian bear? Oh, yeah, Christian bear. He caught over that guy. That old boy, he was laying there on the ground waiting to get eaten by that bear. And he said, oh, Lord, please, oh, Lord, make this a Christian bear. About that time, that bear said, Lord, we thank you for this meal. That's why I don't ever go out in the woods unless I go with somebody that's fatter than me, just in case there's a bear out there. And he said, boy, there's a bear. What are we going to do? I don't know what you're going to do, but I'm going to outrun you. That's how that's going down. Mr. Bear, he's over there. You know, think about what we're saying here. The shepherd was ready to risk his life and give his life for the sheep. And so he would protect. Well, that's who Jesus is for us. I love to think about this. You know those sheep are out there. I don't know how scared they are, but there's a danger, there's a peril to being a sheep out there. They don't even realize. I mean, at any time, a panther or a bobcat or a wolf or a coyote or something bad can come along and tend to business, man, and it'd be all over with. And it don't matter that that sheep doesn't have better sense than to know what danger it's in. The shepherd's there taking care of it all. Are y'all following me on this?
Amen.
Here we are going through life, man. We don't know what we're headed for, but God does.
Right.
And we don't know what's coming, but He does. And He's not scared. And He's with us all the way. And He is protecting us all the way. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. And don't you love this image? He says, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. We are protected in the double hand clenched fist of the Lord Jesus and our Father. He's able to save. He's able to save to the uttermost. Not only that, He is able to keep that which I've committed unto Him against that day. Not only that, He's able to keep me from falling and to present me faultless before His throne in glory with great joy. What an amazing God that we have. He is so able, and we are in His hands. We teach the kids the song. He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got you and me in His hands. I love to sing that with little bitty kids and just go through the whole class and name that one. He's got little Billy and Susie in His hands. Boy, I love it too, boy. Can I just tell you tonight, if I couldn't teach you anything else tonight, He's got you in His hands.
Amen.
You're right there, and He's protecting you. Here's the fifth and final thing. And you know me, I say the best for last, right?
Amen.
When we eat supper tonight, you'll know what I like the most. Whatever last bite is goes in my mouth. And you'll know if there's two things left, one bite of two things, and I'm in a dilemma. I'm about to spin my plate and close my eyes. See what happens. Telling you, I love to save the best for last. And here's the best of the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down His life for the sheep. This is one of the most exciting teachings in all of Scripture. We all know Jesus died on the cross for our sins. I love that. I love the fact that we all know it. I love the fact that little big kids know it. You can show them a cross. What happened there? They'll tell you right quick, like, Jesus died on the cross. And most of them, man, you know, they're 4, 5, 6, 7 years old. You know? Well, why did He die for it? Well, He died for our sins. We know that story. It is a well-publicized story. But I wonder if you knew this about it. Did you know this? Verse 18. No one takes my life from them. Did you know that? You could ask the question, who killed Jesus? One of the greatest preachers that ever came through this part of the world, his name was Earl Glenn. If you wonder who he was or what he was president of Louisiana College. And the big building is named after him. I just so happened to have known him. Isn't that cool? He used to live about 3 doors down from my wife. And he used to have a camp up on Toledo Bend. What a man. And he preached 2 sermons that were just famous. Just famous. One of them was called Why I Love the Church. Oh my goodness, I have to preach it for you someday. Why I Love the Church. Oh, it was so good. The other one was Who Killed Jesus? This man was so eloquent. He would go through this so proper. Just perfect diction and enunciation. Talk like somebody from England or something, you know. Talk the opposite of Brother Steve, basically. And I'll tell you, this guy could preach, man. Oh my goodness, he could preach. And he just went through the whole thing, man. He said, let me tell you something. He said, was the devil, did the Jews kill Jesus? Then he went, did the Romans kill Jesus? Did the religious leaders kill Jesus? Then he went through some things, and he said, you know, Isaiah 53 says the Father had a hand in it. The Father was there. His will was for Jesus to die on the cross and the Father, and it was all about it. He went through and he talked about, maybe it was us. He said, what about you and me and our sins? Our sins never went to the cross, did he? He just went through all kinds of stuff. You know, he just had you just had you on the edge of your seat. He got down to the end of that thing. We all knew what he was going to say. Let me tell you something. Ain't nobody killed Jesus.
Right.
Jesus was not a victim. He was a volunteer. And look, this thing is deeper. Hey, man, we you know, get out, you put the milk aside, get your steak knife out. All right, listen to this. Not only does that mean that he kind of like volunteered for the process, but the Bible says he yielded up his spirit. What that means is that he didn't die, listen to me, he didn't die until he got good and ready. When he got ready to breathe his last, when he got ready to die, he willed for his heart to stop.
Right.
And he willed for his breath to stop. And he yielded up himself and gave himself for all of us. He did it for you.
Man.
He did it for me. Man. And I bet you probably almost knew that, but I wonder if you knew this right here. That same text says, not only do I have the power to lay it down,
amen,
but I have the power to take it right
that's
back
it.
Up again.
That's it.
Now, there's three things in the Bible where the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are intricately involved. Creation, the baptism of Jesus, and the resurrection of Jesus. But don't let the fact that the Father raised him up, and the Bible says that the power of the Holy Spirit raised him, don't let that make you overlook what he said in John 10. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to pick it up again. When he was there in that tomb, when he got ready to wiggle his toes, he went to wiggling. When he got ready to breathe earthly air again, he didn't have a problem doing it. And that stone sure didn't get in the way. Some people say the stone didn't get rolled away to let him out. The stone got rolled away to let others see the emptiness of it. Man, I'm going to tell you right now, Jesus has the power to lay down his life, and he has the power to take it up again. The theology of that is in Revelation chapter 1. He says, I've got the keys to death. I've got the keys to life. And I've got the keys to eternity. You know what it means to have the keys? I have the keys to a green car. And that means that I can drive it, ride it. Today I went down a muddy road and the lady said, you can't take that car down that muddy road. I said, watch. I'm telling you right now, you own it. It's yours. You have power over it, right?
Amen.
I want you to know tonight that Jesus has the power over life.
Amen.
He's got the power over your life. He's got the power over death. He owns it. It's his. He belongs. He's the boss. He's the money. He's the boss. He belongs it. He owns life. And he owns death. And he owns eternity. And if there's something else that we don't know about, he owns that too. This is Jesus. He is the good shepherd. He is the great I am. And he owns it all. I have the power to lay down my life. And I have the power to take it up again. You know, one day the Bible teaches that he's going to call the dead to rise.
Yeah.
Did you know that?
Yeah.
Next Monday night, don't miss it. We're going to study Lazarus. It's the coolest text in the whole book of John. It is awesome, man. Woo! And what he said was what? Lazarus? Don't think he didn't know who he's talking to. Lazarus and only Lazarus.
Yeah.
Rest you chumps, stay there a while. Lazarus and only Lazarus come forth. And one day, he's going to call my name.
Amen.
I'm going to get buried on the highest point in Greenwood Cemetery. Did y'all know that? Them sweet people gave me a grave up there. And I told them, they said, where do you want? They said, you want down here by the duck ponds? I'm not ducks. Put me on the highest hill you got. I'm going to be the first one to find me and be in heaven. My boys work at Cleco. I said, put me on the backside of the Cleco bin so I make sure them suckers is ready and ready to go. I'm telling you right now, man, one day he's going to call your name. When he calls your name, you're going to get up. Wow, he has power over life and death. Well, man, I can't do it. This sermon just quit. I'm just going to quit because he's a good shepherd tonight, you know.
Man.
I'm just going to have to quit. Here it is, man. Tonight, if you want to receive his free gift of eternal life, you come. We're going to have a time of invitation. We believe in that. We got an altar. You can pray. You can come and Bring anything you want before the Lord. And you don't need to bring your problems to the pastor. He's just a goober.
Amen.
But you bring your problems to the master, the Lord Jesus. And I'm telling you right now, he is a problem solver, a chain breaker. He can take care of what's going on in your life.
Amen.
And here's the deal. If you'd like to become part of our church, we'd love to have you. Let's all stand together. We're going to stand together. We're going to sing. What are we going to sing?
114.
Kneel at the cross. If you feel the leadership of the Holy Spirit, you come.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely.